current, non-current. Continuing presentation of financial statements. In the profit and loss account, the international accounting standard gives an option. You classify your expenses according to your nature of expense or function of expense. For example, salaries, interest, rates and taxes, insurance, advertising, these are nature of head of expense. But according to their function, you divide into production expenses, administrative expenses, selling expenses, distribution expenses. You are classifying into function. Both the alternatives are permitted. Under IndAS, we have decided to opt for only one, and that is nature of expense and not according to function. You can disclose by way of information, functional classification of expense, that you have salaries, partly it may go to manufacturing expense, partly it may go to administrative expense, partly it may go to selling expense. But in the profit and loss, you have to give according to nature of expense. You can give additional expenses, additional information by way of functional analysis. Extraordinary items. In IndAS, there is no extraordinary item. Because life is, everything can happen in the life, ordinary, extraordinary. It becomes difficult. Difficult to say what is extraordinary. There was that event that the plane came and the World Tower in New York, it went there and the World Tower collapsed. There was a loss. In the books of the in that airline company, the auditors and the company were discussing what is extraordinary. That aircraft was destroyed. That is, loss is extraordinary. Everybody agreed. But because of that loss, next 3 months people stopped traveling. It was so risky. So airline revenue went down because of this incident. That decline, that loss, is it extraordinary or ordinary? That is also because of this event. And this is difficult to compute and all that. So it is, if it is difficult, stop it, leave it. There is no concept of extraordinary item in IFRS, in IAS. There is no concept. Because in the life, anything can happen. Ordinary things can happen. Extraordinary things can happen. It's difficult to judge whether it is ordinary or extraordinary. Stop it. Don't do it. Same thing for capital reserve. We have that if something, some profit is there and we don't want to take to P&L, we take it to capital reserve. In IndAS, in IFRS, in IAS, there is no concept of capital reserve. Capital reserve concept is not there. Reclassification in financial statements. That if you revise your P&L format this time, you have to revise comparative figures of the previous year. Indian law also requires that you have to disclose, you have to recast the figures of the previous year. We just recast, that's all. IndAS will require nature, amount and reason. What you have recast, why you have recast, what is the amount of the recast, you will have to explain. Critical judgments, as we discussed, when we prepare financial statements, we have to make several judgments on valuation, on claims against the company, claims by the company. So many uncertainties are there and we have to make judgment. Judgment can go wrong. And if the judgment can go wrong, there may be effect in the next year's accounts. All these important critical judgments which we have taken, where the impact is very material and it may have some impact in the next year's accounts, you have to explain in detail in IAS. You have to disclose separately. You have to describe it. You have to describe. Next item is estimation of uncertainty. There are a number of uncertainties when we prepare financial statements. But we can't say that we will not prepare until the uncertainty is resolved. Uncertainty continues, but we have to prepare the financial statements. Uncertainties, we have to describe that what is the uncertainty. If there is a demand from excise authority, 500 crores, it is in appeal, we don't know whether it will be payable or not payable. Very significant item. You describe what is the dispute, what is the amount, what is likely, what is not likely. You describe in detail so that the user notes that even if your judgment is wrong, whether provided or not provided, user has all the information. These two items, critical judgments and estimation of uncertainty, these two items are discussed in so much detail in the financial statements that this discussion becomes very useful to the user of financial statements. And these two are features which are very, very important. Because uncertainties are bound to be there. Appeals and arbitrations matters are bound to be there. But the user should have the knowledge. You may have taken wrong decision, provided, not provided. User should have information, not only one figure. Contingent liability is not provided for. That one figure is not enough. You have to give the what are the critical judgments you have made in preparing the financial statements, and what are the uncertainties which were very, very, very important, very significant, where you have taken some decision which can be wrong and which can have effect in the subsequent year's accounts. You have to explain in detail. These two items, in my mind, make the financial statements much more usable to the users of financial statements, and this will be required under IndAS. We go to the second standard, IndAS 2, inventories. There is not very important, standard is almost same, except that work in progress, service provided work in progress, there is cover, AS does not cover, but there is no very important item over here, I will skip. IndAS 7, cash flow statement, no important item, except that bank overdraft, whether to treat as secured financing activity or to treat as a minus cash balance under cash and bank balance. We treat as financing activity, and IndAS says that it should be treated as part of cash management. So instead of treating as the overdraft has increased, instead of saying financing loan borrowed, you adjust in the cash and bank balance, negative balance in the cash and bank balance. There are no extraordinary items as we discussed. Accounting policies, changes in accounting policies, changes in accounting estimates. If we change accounting policy, what we have to do? We are told under Indian situation that because of the change of accounting policy, what is the impact on the profit for the year you have to disclose. India's requirement is totally different. What you have to do is that there will be no effect on current year's P&L. You have to change the comparative of the previous year, retrospective effect. So if you have changed the accounting policy in the current year P&L is according to new policy. Previous year's figure also you prepare according to new policy. And whatever is the opening reserve in that previous year, earlier years, whatever is the effect, you adjust in the opening reserve. And so you do it retrospective calculation instead of affecting the profit or loss for the year. So change in the accounting policy, nothing will come to the P&L of the current year. Nothing will come. Current year will be as per new policy. Previous year will be recast according to new policy. And whatever is earlier years will go in the opening reserves at the beginning of the previous year. Totally different accounting treatment for change in accounting policy. Change in accounting estimate. As we discussed, we prepare the financial statements. There are a number of uncertainties. We have to make number of judgments. We have to make number of estimates. Estimates may change. You estimated a particular liability. It was existing at the beginning. It is existing at the end also, same liability. But at the end, your valuation is different because of changes, circumstances have changed. Same liability, valuation is different at the end of the year compared to the beginning. Same liability. Do you have to disclose the difference? The answer is no. You see, in the business, change is permanent. Change is going to happen. So whatever change has taken place has to remain in current year's P&L. You don't have to disclose separately. Change in accounting estimate, no separate disclosure required. Error. prior period error you are rectifying. Some error was there in the previous year. What we do is, under AS, in Indian situation, we adjust in the current year and we say current year's profit is increased or decreased because of prior period item so much. It remains in current year. In IndAS, it will not remain in current year. You will revise previous year's comparative. And if error was earlier than the previous year, which does not come in your financial statement, in that case it will go to opening reserves. So you rectify the error and retrospectively rather than having effect in the current year. Events after the reporting period. Proposed dividend. Accounts of a company year end is 31st March. Directors meet in the month of June and propose a dividend for the last year. It is proposed after 31st March in the month of June. But still we give the effect because our law requires at the moment. But in IndAS, it is not to be reflected because it is after 31st March. It will go as a distribution of profit in the next year. When you pay the dividend, you don't have to provide in the earlier year because decision is taken after 31st March. There is a difference between current AS and Schedule 3. Schedule 3 takes care of the new IFRS, new IndAS. Current AS is different, but current AS is under revision to come in line with this. Breach of long-term loan arrangement. You have taken a long-term loan. There is a clause in the agreement that if you default in your any term of the loan, in that case that liability becomes payable immediately. Whatever installments payable in future, you have to pay quarterly installments over a period of next 7 years. But if there is a default, everything becomes payable immediately. Now your distinction of current liability and non-current liability. The loan is payable in the next 7 years, so it is a non-current liability. But if there is a default, it becomes a current liability. Because legally it becomes payable immediately. That is your loan agreement says. Now supposing there is a lender agrees that no, we will not look at that default. We exempt you. And then it can continue as non-current. You need not classify as current. But supposing that agreement by the lender happens after the balance sheet date. There is a default before the balance sheet date. There is a default. So on the balance sheet date, strictly it has become a non-current, it has become a current liability because there is a default. It has become a current liability because there is a default before the balance sheet date. But after the balance sheet date, but before you prepare the financial statements, the lender has agreed to forgive on that issue. In that case, according to international standard, it has happened after balance sheet date. You can't take care of that. Your liability will remain, everything become current under the international standard. Under Indian situation, we have taken the view that our lenders are more sensible. they don't mind small defaults. And so, if a lender has agreed to close his eyes at the default, after the balance sheet date, it is event after the balance sheet date, but we can give effect on the balance sheet date. Strictly it has become current, but we can continue as non-current because of the carve-out which has been made under the IndAS. According to IFRS, it will become current. In Indian standard, IndAS, we will treat as non-current because in India, defaults are normal. And the lender's agreement to close eyes at the default is also normal. And that is why we have big NPS in so many banks. And then we discuss what should be the ways and means to stop this NPS. Standard on income tax. Timing difference, temporary difference when you compute deferred tax asset, deferred tax liability. In India, it is based on timing difference, book profit and tax profit. Whatever difference is between the two, which are reversible in future, creates a deferred tax asset or deferred tax liability. In IndAS, based on IFRS, you don't prepare by comparing book profit and tax profit. You prepare by looking at the balance sheet value, fixed assets. What is the return on value in the books? What is the return on value in the income tax record? Tax in the tax return, what is the return on value? On the difference, you create deferred tax liability. So you don't look at your P&L differences time, to find out timing differences. You look at balance sheet. What is the value of investment? In investment, you may have a particular value of investment. In the books, you might have provided something. So it value has come down in the books. But in investment, value has gone up because of index asset. So in the same investment, in the books, value has come down because you have made some provision. In income tax, the value has gone up because of the index asset. The difference between the two, on that you create your deferred tax asset or liability. If that difference gives you a benefit in future tax liability, it is a deferred tax asset. If it has an adverse effect, it is a deferred tax liability. And so, this instead of P&L approach, there is a balance sheet approach in the new IndAS compared to AS. Compared to AS 22, IndAS 12 approach is based on balance sheet. Carry forward unused income tax losses, unabsorbed depreciation, carry forward loss, it creates a deferred tax asset. Because in future, when you earn income, you will have to pay less tax because of your carry forward benefit. So it is a deferred tax asset. Now that deferred tax asset, whether to create, not create, in India, if there is a carry forward loss situation, it is considered as a, you have to bring in the books if there is virtual certainty. That because you have carry forward loss, that doesn't mean that you have deferred tax asset. Because you have carry forward loss. But what is the guarantee that you will have profit in future where you will get the benefit? Supposing your losses are going to continue forever, that deferred tax loss has no meaning. And so, unless there is a virtual certainty that in the past there were losses, that becomes an asset at present if we have a guarantee that in future we will have income. And so, virtual certainty, convincing evidence, what is required under the income AS 22. IndAS requirement is slightly more relaxed. Instead of virtual certainty, it requires reasonable certainty. It requires whether that benefit is probable or not. Probable means more likely than not. More likely than not means more than 50% chance. So if you have a more than 50% chance, you can recreate your deferred tax asset under IndAS. In AS, you have to have convincing evidence and you have to have virtual certainty that you will get that benefit. So yardstick is slightly relaxed. Deferred tax as liability on asset revaluation. If your fixed asset, you revalue, book value goes up. It revaluation doesn't have effect on P&L, it goes to reserve. So there is no impact in the Indian accounting standard on income tax. You don't have to create deferred tax liability because of revaluation. But in IndAS, your book value has gone up, but your income tax return on value remains same. There you will not get this increase. And so there is a gap between book value and tax value. It creates a deferred tax liability, which you have to create on revaluation, and which you have to create based on the assumption that you will sell the asset and not use the asset in future. Deferred tax liability on unrealized group profits. You are consolidating subsidiary and holding. Subsidiary's profit, holding company's profit, you add the two. But you ignore that subsidiary's profit, when you distribute and when it comes to holding company's books, you will have to pay tax. That tax is ignored. But under the new standard, IndAS, that tax has to be provided. That whatever is the profit of subsidiary and holding company, you can't just add up. Because that profit of subsidiary, when it travels to the books of holding company, you have to pay tax. And that tax liability must be taken into consideration when you prepare your consolidation. Potential tax benefit on business combination, that if you are combining, you are taking over another company and there are deferred tax losses over there, which you will be able to get benefit under the income tax law. In that case, how to take in consideration. classification of deferred tax liability, it is always considered as non-current under IndAS. You don't have to decide current or non-current. It is always non-current. Tax effect of income tax or expenses recognized outside P&L. Some income, instead of bringing to P&L, you have taken directly to reserve. Or some expense, directly to reserve. So some expense you have adjusted against share premium directly, instead of bringing P&L. Now, if your income or expense has not come to P&L, it has gone directly to reserve, tax effect on that income or expenditure should also follow. If it has, income has not come to P&L, tax on income should not come to P&L. Income has gone to reserve, tax also should go to reserve. Like that dog travels in that Vodafone advertisement, that follow the network, follow the network. Wherever you go, the dog follows. Same way, if the income goes, instead of P&L, it goes to reserve, the tax on that income from P&L, it goes to reserve. Dog follows the network. numerical tax rate reconciliation. You have to prepare a special reconciliation. That supposing your income of is 100 crores and tax rate applicable is 34%. So if your book profit is 100 crore, 34% is the applicable tax rate, tax liability should be 34 crore. But your actual tax provision is more or less because of disallowances, because of incentives. You have to give the reconciliation that based on 100 crore at the rate applicable to the company, provision should have been 34 crore. But we have provided 32 or we have provided 37 because of certain disallowances and because of certain incentives. You have to give the reconciliation. So the user knows that how your tax provision is more or less compared to the applicable tax rate. This reconciliation is required. Property, plant and equipment, fixed assets. How many hours are pending? I think at this rate it will go, it will take 8 hours. I will increase the speed now. So when your target is near, you have to run faster. So I will increase. Property, plant and equipment. Componentization of property plant, we have discussed already. Replacement cost, if in an asset, particular major part you replace. In Indian situation, AS, what you do, that you look at the new cost incurred and you decide whether it to capitalize or to treat as revenue. Replacement. Here, whatever is the return on value of that part, remove from the books, and whatever you are spending, you capitalize, provided it is a major part in that new asset. Cost of major inspection, that some aircraft or ship, every 4 or 5 years, you have to do certain type of checks, regulatory, overhauling of that ship or the aircraft, and you incur abnormal expenditure every 4 or 5 years. How to treat that? You are allowed to amortize over 3 or 4 years. If next time again comes after 4 years, whatever is unamortized amount of the previous over expenditure, that you write off, and whatever new you are there, again you start amortizing. So that is the cost of inspection. Major spare parts, if it is related to specific machinery, it should be added in the cost of machinery, and instead of treating as P&L and consumption, it should be depreciated along with the cost of fixed asset. Revaluation, we discussed that you have the option, fixed asset, whether to follow cost model or revaluation model. Supposing you decide to follow revaluation model, it's not like Indian situation that you revalue your fixed asset because you are going for public issue. You revalue. And then next 7 years, don't do anything else, just provide depreciation. After 7 years, if you look at that asset in your books, what it is? Is it based on cost? No. Before 7 years, you revalued. Cost disappeared. Is it based on fair value on the balance sheet date? No. Fair valuation was done before 7 years. It is 7 years, that fair value before 7 years minus depreciation. So it is neither cost nor fair value. IndAS will require, decide You want cost or you want fair value? If you want fair value, revaluation once upon a time is not enough. You have to do every year, you have to look at your revalue, you have to look at the fair value. If it is very different, you have to bring in the books, the difference. Method of depreciation schedule 2, we have discussed that not statutory rate of depreciation, but you are given the alternate, it is more based on your judgment on the use of the useful life. Change in the method of depreciation. It is considered as a change in the method of estimate, because after all, depreciation is an estimate of the amortization of the cost of the asset over the useful life of the asset. It is an estimate, and so it is treated as a change in the estimate. It is not given effect with retrospective effect, as it is done under Indian situation sometimes. Dismantling the cost, etc., should be provided. If you have a mine, and when you close the mine, you have to incur some expenditure to restore the site. Or when you dismantle the asset, you have to incur some cost at the end. You should factor in the cost and you should provide the depreciation right from the beginning. So some costs which are to be incurred at the end should be factored right from beginning and depreciated. Leasehold land is not covered under Indian accounting standard because land has special features in India. IndAS will cover it. Indirect expenses. Supposing you have given lease of the car to the agent, you pay the commission. Lease rental is for 3 years. Whatever commission you have paid to the agent, is it expense of the first year or you can amortize over the income which you are going to earn in the next 3 years? IndAS requires you amortize over the income which you are going to earn. You are paying agent, you are going to get income in the next 3 years, so you amortize over that income. There is appendix A, B and C to cover special situations. Employee benefits, actuarial gains and losses. Our AS said it should go to P&L. If your actuarial gains and losses, your actuarial liability for gratuity goes up and down because of various factors. Because the investment return has changed, because the discounting rate on the liability has changed, because the mortality of the employee has changed, because of the retirement age has changed, because of several factors. The actuarial gains and losses are there during the year because your actuarial assumptions change during the year. This how they should be treated. AS 15 said it should go to P&L, which was very, very difficult. There can be huge losses on actuarial liability of gratuity, etc. IFRS gave some option of corridor approach that we amortize over a period of vesting. Finally, IFRS says it should go to other comprehensive income, and under IndAS that is accepted, and there is no carve out now. It is accepted that whatever is the employee liability, actuarial gains or losses impact on the P&L, it will not go in the first part of P&L. It will go in that other comprehensive income, and this there is no carve out with IFRS now. Discount rates for gratuity liability, etc. What discount rate you should apply, based on government rate bonds or based on high quality corporate bonds? International standard allows high quality corporate bonds. We don't have much faith, so we have more faith in government, and so we accept only government rates to decide the market value and to decide the discounting rate. Termination benefit liability I discussed, VRS, legal liability based on applications up to the balance sheet date, that is legal, form, substance, what is the total liability you expect because of your VRS announcement, that you provide, that is substance, and IndAS talks about substance, our AS talks about the form. Accounting grant, how to account, I'm not going to discuss. It includes the disclosure of government assistance. And that grant, if you have received against that asset, should you credit to asset account? To your plant and machinery, part of the cost is given as a grant by the government. Do you adjust against plant? Answer is no. IndAS says no credit to asset account. Take as deferred income. Take to the income according to the corresponding expenditure. For depreciation, whatever goes to debit side of P&L, part of that income from the deferred income you shift it to the P&L account. So deferred income is the treatment which is suggested. If you get non-mandatory grant, something is given, a non-monetary asset, how to value? Indian standard allows two alternatives, fair value or nominal value. And IndAS allows only fair value option. Government loan with below market rate of interest, you have to do the accounting if you are given concessional rate of interest. Change in the foreign exchange rates. This was a very controversial subject in the past, that you have imported machinery. A liability is payable in foreign currency and the rupee value of liability goes up because the value of the rupee in the foreign exchange market has come down. Rupee liability goes up, that increase in liability, whether to debit to the cost of the asset account or whether to debit to P&L account. And that was a matter of controversy. And there was a clause 46A in standard A that you were allowed the option. Schedule 6 earlier said you can add to the cost of asset. Then the standard says it should go to P&L. There was a dispute between the two. And then there was 46A that you can take to the cost of fixed asset, or if it is a long-term liability, you can amortize over a period. That option was given in 46A. Now, the situation is that when you transition to IndAS, whatever is that past option, whatever is the carry forward on the transition date, you can continue the policy. That is the carve out. But in a new exchange difference in future, now 46A or 29A of the new standard is not applicable now, and now you have to take it to P&L. So any exchange difference which arises after the transition date to IndAS will go to P&L. Past carry forward can continue according to the old policy. IndAS 21 continues that the accounting treatment for investment in foreign corporation I have discussed. It goes to other comprehensive income. Forward exchange contracts, they were discussed in AS under standard 11, that forward contract taken for hedging business transaction or taken for speculation purpose, forward contract, how to do the accounting, it was covered by AS 11. Now that forward contract is a derivative and it will be covered by the standard on financial instrument. Borrowing cost, there is no significant difference. Related party disclosures are different, but there is no accounting difference, and we have to take care of IndAS requirements plus Companies Act requirement. Companies Act lays down elaborate requirements of related party disclosure which we have to comply with, but there is no accounting implication. Separate financial statements. If you are preparing consolidation, but also you are preparing a financial statements of holding company, the parent company. In the parent company's books, investment in subsidiary, how should you value? Whether to value at cost or what to do? If you are preparing consolidation, you are doing consolidation, it is taken care of. But you are not doing consolidation. We are not talking about consolidated financial statements. Even if you are preparing consolidated financial statements, you are also preparing financial statements of the parent company. In the parent company's books, investment in subsidiary, how should it be recorded? In Indian situation, we value at cost only. In IFRS, you are allowed to do equity accounting. That according to the net worth of that company, whatever is the appreciation or depreciation in the net worth, you can bring in your investment in the old parent company's books, investment in subsidiary, you can revalue according to the your share in the net worth assets of that subsidiary. That is there in IFRS, but in India there is a carve out. We don't agree and we don't allow this equity method under IndAS. Associate and joint venture, that if you are having joint venture or investment in associate, your associate means you have significant influence over that company. You are holding more than 20%, but less than 50%. You don't have control, but you have significant influence. How you do the accounting? As we discussed, equity method and proportionate consolidation. Proportionate consolidation is out. You have to do equity method. But in the books, separate books of the investor, equity method is not permitted. Only in the consolidated balance sheet, equity method is permitted. So in the parent company's books, investment in associate, you can't revalue according to the net worth of that company. Equity accounting is not permitted under Indian situation. It is a carve out. Under IFRS, it is permitted. And when you do this, your share in that other company, if there are some shares, debentures which are going to be converted into equity at a later date, tell you, do you consider that potential equity shares or no? Answer is yes, if it should be considered. Hyperinflationary economy, standard is prepared even in India, though we are not in that situation. Our inflation is in control. Hyperinflation means that within 3 years, inflation rate is more, is around 100%, reaching 100 or more than 100 within 3 years, rate of inflation. Then you have to apply this standard. If you apply this standard, whatever is the rate on the balance sheet date, whatever is the value of your currency, at that value you have to value everything of the past, entire year, entire previous year. You have to take closing rate, because every day the value of your rupee changes because of the inflation. And so this is a very strict standard, but not applicable in India. Our governor of Reserve Bank is very powerful, and the inflation is under control. This standard is not applicable. Applicable on paper, but we will not have a requirement of looking at this standard. Now we come to financial instruments. We have a standard on investment, IA, accounting standard 13, which is very simple standard, simple, sister of dimple. So investments, financial instrument is a much wider concept. Financial instrument includes investment, but it includes so many other things. Financial instrument is a contract which gives asset from the point of view of one party, and which gives equity or liability from the point of view of another party. So on the liability side, equity and every liability is a final contract with other party is a financial contract, and on asset side of the other party of the contract. So equity instrument is a financial instrument, debentures is a financial instrument, derivative contract, embedded derivative, we will discuss all this. There are various situations, and financial instrument standard covers everything. Financial instrument standard is very complex, and so financial instruments, and if you look at IFRS, there was IAS 32, then IAS 39, and then IFRS 9. IAS 32 and IAS 39 and IFRS 7, there is a history. Actually, it was one standard. The intention was one standard, financial instrument. But presentation disclosure is easy. Measurement is difficult. And so when the IAS 32 was framed, presentation and disclosure was prepared, the standard. Measurement was said that we will tackle after some years. After 4 or 5 years, measurement standard was prepared. In between, some new standards got in. So next standard became IAS 39. 32 and 39, in between new standards came. There was a gap of 3-4 years between 32 and 39. Now that 39 will be replaced by IFRS 9. And we are one step ahead. We will not go to 39 at all. Instead of you going via that, we will go directly to IFRS 9. IAS 39, we will never follow. 39, we will never follow. We will directly go to IFRS 9. Now that 32, 39. So in one international situation, presentation disclosure was considered first 32. Then disclosure, IFRS 7 was prepared. It was removed from 32. Separate standard was prepared, more elaborate. In India, we are bold. If there is difficult thing in the, it's not like exam that student tackles easy thing first. That was this international standard setters did. That easy thing they did first, presentation disclosure. And measurement recognition difficult, they took later on. So they followed student psychology in the exam. Easy questions first. But we want to show our boldness. And so we prepared the standards 30, 31, 32. Recognition measurement 30, we tackled first. 30. Presentation 31, later. Disclosure 32, later. Now you will remember that numbering, if you remember this logic. That there is always way of, there is a way of remembering the things. And this is, this you should learn this technique. Now you will never forget 30, 31, 32. Which one is first? Measurement first. At what time you have to hand over the work? You tell me, eh? This, we frame 30, 31, 32. But what is mandatory at the moment in our accounting standard rules of 2006, which are mandatory at the moment, which is mandatory? Only AS 13, invest. Because 30, 31, 32 were never made mandatory. They have remained recommendatory forever. And now it will come, IndAS will come. So 30, 31, 32, they remain on paper. They are never made mandatory. Even they have been made recommendatory. If you ask me that if there is a financial instrument, complex instrument, how to value, if you look at AS, you get no guidance. Because AS 13 talks only about investment. 30, 31, 32 are not effective. Recommendatory, if you want, you can follow. But otherwise do what you like. Except that there is some notification of the institute, some circular was issued, that on derivative contracts, some companies suffered huge losses, and those huge losses should be provided, not because the standard requires, but because the concept of prudence requires. And so you should provide, that was a declaration by the institute, notification by the institute. But it never came in the standards. Financial instruments is the area which is not covered by AS at the moment at all, except investments, and except recommendatory 30, 31, 32. There is no effective standard. But now, when we move to IndAS, we will have the standards. And this, in international scene, measurement was 39. 39 was very complex. Financial instrument itself is a complex topic. It's difficult to claim expertise on financial instruments. Every accountant cannot have. Some people have, but we can't. It's very difficult. So, financial instruments is very, very complex. IAS 39, very complex. When there was a global crisis, G20 leaders met. G20 declarations that did. It included our Dr. Manmohan Singh also. And they made a declaration that in the accounting standards, the financial instrument standards are very complex, and the standard setters should try to simplify. And so ISB and FSB, International Standards and US GAAP, FSB, they had a joint project to simplify financial instruments. And by after simplifying, now what they have prepared is the IS 32 remains, disclosure goes to 7, and IAS 39 will go to IFRS 9, but IFRS 9 will become effective in 2018. So IFRS 9 is to simplify IAS 39, because G20 leaders directed. So this IAS 39 has become IFRS 9 because of the G20 declaration. And they have tried to simplify. But you know, our income tax has been simplified so many times. But it still remains complex. It same thing happens here. Because fundamentals of life you can't change. So simplification effort is done, that gives the satisfaction. IFRS 9, the project was divided into three parts. Classification and measurement of financial assets and financial liabilities, impairment of debt instruments, etc., and hedging. It was divided into three parts. And all three parts were tackled separately. In 2009, first part was completed, financial assets. 2010, financial liabilities project was completed. Later on, impairment, hedging, all were completed. Last version was completed in July 2014. It will be applicable on the international scene from 2018. We are one step ahead. It is very complex, but we are master in tackling complex things. So we will implement from 16-17 accounting year, comparative previous year. So 1/4/15. Today we are in June 15. So previous year implementation has started. Because 1st April 15 is the transition date for your 16-17 accounts. So today it is applicable for the prior year figures of 16-17. So we will not go to IndAS IS 39 at all. We will go directly to IndAS 109. Now there were two categories, IS 1 to 41 and IFRS 1 to 15. We have only IndAS. There is no IAS and IFRS. How to distinguish? We always find out the solution. And the solution is that IAS 1 to 41, our numbering is IndAS 1 to 41, IndAS. But if it is IFRS 1, our numbering is IndAS 101. Our category starts from 101. So by numbering, we have distinguished whether it is IAS or it is IFRS. If I say 103, it is IFRS because it is 100 category. If I say IndAS 3, it is IAS, based on IAS. And whatever they have kept blanks out of 41, we have also kept blanks. We have kept numbering same. So at least, see, inside the standard interpretation may be difficult, but numbering we have kept easy. numbering you don't have to remember that if my IndAS is 35, what is comparatively IAS number? You don't have to remember, it is same number. Because we have kept same numbering. So we have tried to simplify numbering. Inside it may be difficult. Financial instrument standard. I have discussed the history, what 32, 39, IFRS 107, IFRS 9, 7, IFRS 9, IndAS 107, 109, with the history I discussed. Now, what are the important features? It is distinct from investment, we have discussed. Substance over form is used for redeemable preferences. Presentation, we saw as capital. In financial instrument, in the AS 32, it will be shown as debt, not as a capital. Because redeemable preference, you have to redeem. After 10 years, it is redeemable. So it is not an equity, it is a payable after 10 years. Just you call it preference capital, it doesn't become equity, it is a debt. And convertible debenture, fully convertible debenture. Though it is a debenture at the moment, after 2 years, it is fully convertible into equity. Then it should be presented not under the debenture, not under the debt, it should be presented under equity, because it's going to be converted into equity definitely, mandatorily. So presentation is according to substance, not according to form. Because of the substance, redeemable preference capital becomes a liability and convertible debenture becomes an equity. Conversion option embedded in FCCB. You have issued foreign currency convertible bonds. You have issued foreign currency convertible bonds, FCCB. These bonds, after 3 years, are going to be converted into equity shares. How many equity shares you will get against what amount is decided now only. That against so much, for foreign exchange value, you will get so many equity shares. It is decided now. Now this FCCB, it will become equity after 3 years. But until 3 years, it's a liability. Every liability has to be revalued according to the foreign exchange rate prevailing on the balance sheet date. So every quarter, every year, you have to value your FCCB because of foreign exchange rates. FCCB book value goes up and down. But finally, after 3 years, you are going to convert into equity. And what will be the equity capital, you can tell now also. Because how many equity shares you are going to issue, you already know. If it is going to remain same equity after 3 years, why to revalue that FCCB every quarter, every year? IFRS requires. But we are more intelligent. And we have decided we will not revalue. IFRS says that if there is an equity embedded option, if it is a local currency, functional currency of the company, then you need not, it is equity, you need not revalue. Equity on the does not require revaluation according to foreign exchange rates. But debt requires revaluation according to foreign currency on the balance sheet date. So debt requires revaluation according to foreign currency fluctuation. Equity does not require. IFRS says if the convertible bond is the same currency of the company, it is equity, you need not. If it is foreign, it is a debt, you should do. We have said whether it is our currency, functional currency of the company, or it is foreign currency, we will treat as equity and we will not revalue. Because it is senseless that my FCCB rupee value, because of foreign exchange rupee value going up and down, FCCB is in dollar, rupee value goes up and down, doing it for 3 years, and after 3 years it will be equity capital and that amount remains unchanged. Why to do every year fluctuation? We have avoided. We said whether it is foreign currency or local currency, we will treat as equity and we will not revalue the exchange difference on every balance sheet date. This is the carve out from IFRS. Under Indian situation, we will follow our rule. Disclosures. 107, the financial instrument standard I am taking all together. And so from IS 32, in the IS 32, I am directly going to 107 because it is a financial instrument. We discussed presentation, it is disclosure. Lot of disclosures are required for financial instruments. You have to give qualitative disclosure that what is the risk under the financial instrument, how you are managing your risk. You have to give lot of disclosure. And you have to give quantitative disclosure. If your credit risk, market risk, price risk, all this risk, what is the quantity aspect? So credit risk, debts we divide into more than 6 months, less than 6 months. Why? Because of the risk. More than 6 months, less than 6 months, debts, credit risk. Same way we divide all this. We also divide the credit risk, liquidity, market risk. All we have to give quantitative details. We have to give sensitivity analysis also. Supposing you are a bank, if rate of interest goes up by 1%, or goes down by 1%, what can be the impact on the bank? You have to give a sensitivity analysis. So lot of disclosures required under this financial instrument. Recognition measurement. This is easy because we tackled it first. So what is contract? We have discussed financial instrument, three parts, discussed separately later on in stages. We have discussed financial assets and liabilities. Initially, they are valued at fair value. Transaction cost is normally included unless you are valuing at fair value subsequently. Subsequent measurement, financial assets, whether to value at cost or fair value. If fair value, appreciation goes to P&L or to other comprehensive income. There are various methods. Coming to debt instrument, if it is a loan or a bond or a debenture in which you have invested, how to value? As we discussed, look at your business model. Loan, if you are given, your intention is to keep the loan, recover, maturity is over a period of 3 years, you record maturity, what you are going to get, future value you discount, and that is your fair value. But if you are also sometimes the entire loan portfolio, you sell, that means that you may not continue the contract. You have to look at the market value. So if I have investment in government bond and my policy is that I never sell, I keep until maturity. Government bond, if matures after 4 years, I will take the money after 4 years. Then whatever I get on maturity or whatever interest I get for next 4 years, I find out the present value. That is the fair value of a government bond. And that bond is traded in the market. I know the market value in the market, but I will not look at, because I never sell government bond. Why should I look at the market value? I look only at discounted value. That is called amortized cost. It is called amortized cost. It is actually discounted value of money receivable, but it is called cost, because sometimes names can be misleading. We used to learn single entry, and there was always double entry when you prepare balance sheet. Single entry was converted double entry when you solve the problem. And see, there was one hawker who was selling chicken patties near Churchgate, and he was shouting at the top of his voice, chicken patties 30 rupees, chicken patties 30 rupees. One person bought it. I am vegetarian, so one person bought it. He ate it. There was no chicken inside. So he asked that, "You are shouting chicken patties, there is no chicken inside." The vendor replied, "Sir, do you drink gold spot? Is there any gold inside?" So names can be misleading. So financial instruments we value at amortized cost. What is cost element over there? Nothing. There is no cost. It is the proceeds what you are going to get in the next 4 years until maturity, by way of interest and by way of maturity proceeds, you have discounted, and the present discounted value is called amortized cost. Where is cost here? I don't know. But that answer is same what that vendor gave here. So business model you have to look at. So government bond, if my model is not to sell government bond, I am a bank, and SLR ratio I have to maintain according to Reserve Bank requirement. So I hold the government bond, I keep up to maturity, I never sell. Then market value might have gone down. I will not look at it because I don't sell it. My business model is to keep it. Because of SLR I am keeping. And I will have to keep SLR forever. There is no chance to sell, I don't want to sell. Don't look at market value. Fair value is not market value. Fair value is the discounted value of what you are going to get in future. So fair value is not always the market value. It can be different than market value. Equity instruments, we have discussed that equity instruments have to be valued at fair value, and that you can designate that the appreciation in equity or debt will not go to P&L, it will go to other comprehensive income. That option is available to you, but option you have to exercise at the beginning, and you can't change it. See, once you are in that chakra view, once you have entered, you can't get out. So if you have exercised the option, other comprehensive income, you can't change it. Option for exercise, what happened? Even liability, if some liabilities are connected with some assets, we do the fair value, sir. But some asset is connected with the value of liability. If the two are together, then both go together. In that case, you can have the option of valuing that liability also at fair value, because it has connection with the asset, and should go up and down with that asset. Two are connected items. So because of matching of asset and liability, if asset is fair value, you may decide fair value option even for a liability. That is permitted. You have to exercise that option, and that if you decide that option and that liability, the fair value of that liability goes down. Why? Not because of something happened in the economy. Something happened in your company. Your company is in financial difficulty, so your chances of the ability to pay the liability is less. So somebody is ready to buy the liability at a lower value, and your present creditor is ready to sell it at a lower value. because your present rated feels that your ability to pay is less. So he is ready to get less amount from somebody. So that means liability is valued at a lower value. If liability is valued at a lower value, it's a gain in the books. So because of fair value of your liability going down, there is a gain in the P&L. This is absurd. But it is there in IFRS. We said, no, we don't believe. And so instead of P&L, this item will go to other comprehensive income. That is IFRS's change. And so we have removed the carve out because of our objection, they have changed it. Because of own risk, I have discussed this item. Reclassification of financial assets, you can do it only if your business model change, otherwise you can't do it. If your debt instrument you are valuing at amortized cost, you can't convert into fair value unless your business model has changed. Reclassification of financial liability is not permitted. The next topic is de-recognition, that at what point of time the asset or liability will cease to exist in your books. Asset, at what time it will go out, when you sell or recover, or when it is not recoverable, you write off. Sometimes the asset, you securitize. You have a loan portfolio in your bank, and you convert into debenture, sell to somebody, securitize. In that case, the asset liability in the books of the other party will go down. All these things are there. Derecognition, impairment of financial assets. Bad debts on the loan, we provide based on incurred loss method, that we have given a loan, and after some 2-3 years, if there is a default in payment, we find that the loan is not recoverable. There is impairment of the loan, recovery, and so we make the provision for doubtful loan. We do when the loss is incurred, when we feel that the recovery is doubtful. Now the new philosophy is that don't wait until the incurred loss. Follow expected loss method. That means that when you are given a loan, you know some loan is going to become doubtful. You know, you are giving loans for higher purchase, car, several small loans you are giving. You know that whenever you are giving loan, some percentage of loan is going to become doubtful. So if you are charging, because of that doubtful element, you are charging higher rate of interest. That if normally I charge 10% for loan given, but if loan recovery is risky, I charge 14%. So if you are charging more because there is doubtful element is more, when the loan is risky, you charge higher rate. But that higher rate you take on P&L in the life from beginning. That loss will come after 3-4 years when it becomes bad. That is bad. You can't wait for 3-4 years. You can't. It's bad to wait until the loan becomes bad. You should know in advance. So if you are normally you are charging 10%, you are charging 14% because the loan is risky. Whatever is the expected loss, you start building up the provision right from the beginning. So what is the situation, how you do it in the new philosophy, it is there. Derivative, all derivatives are valued always at fair value. What is derivative? If I entered into a contract, the value of the contract depends upon something else. Rate depends upon rate of foreign exchange. I have imported the goods. I want to pay after 6 months for that liability to my foreign supplier. I go to the bank, that you give me the cover at the for the foreign currency, and the banker gives it. The value of the contract depends upon the valuation rate of foreign exchange coming and going up and down. So if your contract depends upon the rate of exchange, or your contract depends upon inflation, or your contract depends upon the price movement, it is called derivative contract. All this, how should you value, is laid down in this standard. Our present AS does not give any guidance except those recommendatory AS 30, 31, 32. Embedded derivative. What is embedded derivative or hybrid contract? Convertible debenture. Out of that debenture of 100 rupees, 80 coca will remain forever. But 20 rupees debenture will be converted into one equity share. That Reliance philosophy of Dhirubhai Ambani in the previous decade, it was there. That convertible debenture issued, 100 rupee debenture, 80 rupees remains as a debenture forever. 20 rupees debenture after 2 years will be converted into one equity. That equity value is much higher. So your debenture value also quoted in the market at a very high value. Now, so this is embedded contract. The debt, there is an element of option for equity which is embedded in it. You have entered into a lease contract, and in the lease which you have given, the lease rental, you have kept a clause that every year the lease rental will go up according to the rate of inflation. If there is an inflation of 6%, next year the lease rent will go up by 6%. Your contract is of lease for next 10 years, but there is a the embedded derivative of inflation, rate of inflation. Now in that case, how that embedded derivative should be valued? If your host contract, that is lease contract, is a financial instrument, embedded derivative is not separated. If host contract is not a financial instrument, embedded contract is separated. But if both are financial, host contract and the embedded derivative, the lease and the inflation rate, both are financial, in that case, it is not separated, it is valued as one instrument. All these complicated rules are there. Hedge accounting, how you do your risk management activity. You do the hedging of the, you have to pay for import after few year, after some year time. You have to get from your export. You don't want to take the risk of the foreign exchange fluctuation. You agree with the rate of exchange with the banker now only. Then you take forward contract. All this will be covered over here. How you do the hedging, what are the rules of hedge accounting. There are very, very complicated rules. Earning per share, EPS, how to compute. In the EPS, separate disclosure is required for continuing, compression, discontinuing. If you have decided to dispose of a part of your business, you should compute separate EPS. In the P&L also, you have to say, so separate profit, continuing, discontinuing. EPS also separate. There is no extraordinary item. We have discussed that. Mandatory convertible debentures considered in EPS. Interim financial reporting, that if you are doing interim reporting every quarter or every half year, what are the rules of the game you have to follow? Our 41 agreement quarterly, SEBI requirements of quarterly, actually it is not an interim reporting because it doesn't give complete financial statements. It gives only some financial information under clause 41. It doesn't come under this. But the rules of recognition and measurement for quarterly, whatever is here, should be followed. That is the requirement. Impairment of asset, that when your asset is not enough to provide depreciation. If the value has come down, impairment should be provided. Once it is provided, whether you can reverse or not reverse, those rules are laid down. Liability, legal obligation, constructive obligation, VRS scheme we have discussed. Termination liability we have discussed. It's a constructive obligation under IndAS. Discounting of liability should be done if it is material. If liability is payable after 3 years without interest, you can do the discounting, which is not permitted under AS. Discounting is not permitted under AS. There are some appendixes to cover special situations. Intangible assets, trademarks, copyrights, license, intangible assets, how to measure whether you can revalue these assets. IndAS permits under certain situations. Intangible asset, whether you should amortize or you should impair. That if value has come down, you record the loss, or every year a part of it you amortize. Indian standard requires both. Amortization, there is a rebuttable assumption, presumption, that 10 years. Life does not exceed 10 years, that is rebuttable. If it is different, you have to prove why, how it is different. Otherwise, you have to amortize within 10 years. In amalgamation, if there is a goodwill, it has to be amortized within 5 years. These are the rules under amortization, under Indian situation. IndAS requires only impairment. Intangible assets, website cost, how to value, there is a appendix. Investment property, you have got immobile property. You are not using for business. It's not your business premises. You have acquired the property as an investment. Intention is to earn appreciation and to earn rental. If it is your investment, it's not a business, it's not a fixed asset. You are not using for your business. It's your investment. In that case, how to value? There is a cost model and fair value model. Under IndAS, only cost model is allowed, fair value model is out. Agriculture. In agriculture, it's not like manufacturing that raw material you convert into finished goods. You are converting only. In biological assets, you not only conversion, some new things can come. There can be new crops grow up because of nature. Animals, quantity goes up, cows and buffaloes go up because of new birth. So in biological assets, it's not only conversion from raw material to finished goods. Because of the new birth, regenerative assets, the new items come, how to value them. Cost is difficult, fair value is the model. But if fair value cannot be computed, cost model allowed as an exception, that is given. And there is one carve out which was there, that bearer plant, that if there is a plant which gives you agriculture produce, IAS, international standard required, you value that plant also. Indian situation said, no, plant we would not like to value. Plant would like to keep as it is. Only the crop we would like to value. So there was a discussion. In IFRS has been amended because of our objection, and so carve out is dropped, and bearer plant will not be revalued at market value. It is considered as PPE, property, plant and equipment, and it will be treated as a just like fixed asset, not revalued at fair value every period. First time adoption of IndAS. When you are adopting IndAS for the first time, what are the rules of the game are provided in this standard? Whether you have to do comparative, or also according to IndAS, according to the new standard. Earlier, before 4 years, we took a decision, no, we will not do, we will have shortcut. Previous year, gap, whatever is there, we will use it. Now that carve out is removed, comparative also will have to be according to IndAS, according to the new standard. So 16, 17 accounts, 15, 16 prior period will have to be as per IndAS, as per the new standard. That carve out has been removed. So date of transition we discussed, beginning of the previous year. Comparative we discussed, reconciliation we have discussed. Previous gap carrying value can be considered as deemed cost. This is a very important carve out. Property, plant and development, intangible assets, and investment property, these three assets. When you are transitioning from AS to IndAS in the first year, how do you take the value? Supposing you want to follow cost model for property, plant and equipment. Cost you have incurred before some years. You have provided depreciation. If you want to do correct transition, you should go back to the purchase of that fixed asset, work out depreciation according to IFRS requirement, IndAS requirement, and work out the return on value, what it should have been on the date of transition. Very difficult to go in the past. Option given. Fair value on date of transition, use as the dim cost. That is the option given. All right, fair value, but then you have to find out market value. Fair value also difficult. Under IndAS, we have given one more carve out, that whatever is the carrying amount, we will take as fair value, dim cost. So if you are transitioning to IndAS, you don't have to do any going into the past for your dim cost. You don't have to do. You can take fair value, book value, carrying value in the old gap, you can take as the value for the purpose of transition. Very, very important exemption. This standard lays down that when you are converting to the new standard, for which item you should go retrospective and for which items you need not go. Supposing amalgamation, before 3 years you have done one amalgamation. Should you revisit according to a new method or you need not? Answer is you need not. You are exempted. But if you want to do it, you have to do for all the amalgamations in the earlier year. So there are rules of the game for the transition in the first year. Share-based payments, there is a guidance, ESOP to the employees. We have a guidance note of the institute. We have a SEBI regulations are there. How you value your ESOPs, etc. this standard is on that. But this standard covers not only shares issued to the employees. Shares you may issue to the supplier of the goods or services. That also is covered by this standard. And how to value our standard institute's guidance note gives option, intrinsic value, fair value, the recommended fair value, but here no option, fair value is required under business combination, merger of the two companies. I will try to cover within 10 or 15 minutes. Is it okay or should I stop? Time is exceeded. 10, 15 minutes?
Yes, sir.
10 minutes?
Yes, sir.
Those who agree may stay here. Those who don't agree can go out. 10 minutes. Option is yours. I will try to cover within 10 minutes. This is slide 48. The total slides are 79. But this 79 slides covers the entire journey from AS to IndAS. Every standard IndAS out of 39 is covered in these slides. Each and every IndAS out of 39. Merger of the two companies. You are taking over another company, absorption, amalgamation of two companies. There are two methods, pooling, acquisition method, pooling interest method. Acquisition method, you take over assets, you take over liabilities, you pay consideration, difference if you pay more goodwill, if you pay less capital reserve. This is the situation. Merger method, there is no goodwill, there is no acquisition, two companies are there, they combine, assets are added, liabilities are added, capital is exchanged, and reserves are also added. In that method, acquisition method, reserves did not come. You took over assets and liabilities. You did not take over reserves in acquisition method. In amalgamation method, pooling of interest, even reserves, profits are amalgamated. But if you pay different capital than what is there, that goes in the amalgamation reserve. So goodwill doesn't come, amalgamation reserve comes. Now, there are exceptions here. Under Ind AS, first of all, under AS, you take over assets and liabilities. Excess is goodwill. But there is an immovable property with that company. Fair value is much more. In Indian standard allows you take over at book value. But in valuing what you are paying, you take into consideration fair value. You pay more. But that more you are not valuing, immovable property. You are taking over at book value. That excess goes where? To goodwill account. Because the excess goes to goodwill account under Indian situation. Under this new standard, you have to fair value every asset and liabilities which you are taking over. You can't take over at book value. That is one exception. Then, between acquisition and pooling of interest, our Indian standard, AS 14, clause 3, lays down 5 conditions. If all the 5 conditions are satisfied, you can follow pooling of interest. All the 5 should be satisfied. Like Vaidya Rehman has 4 uncles. Vaidya Rehman wants to marry Sunil Dutt. She says, if all the 4 uncles agree, I can marry you. That is what Vaidya told Sunil Dutt. In some new film, there are 3 uncles instead of 4. But anyway, so all should agree. Here also, pulling of interest, all the 5 conditions should be satisfied. Then only you can follow pulling of interest. That is Indian standard. But if you all are satisfied, you can follow pooling of interest. But the new standard, pooling of interest is out. You can follow only acquisition. Because international standard, pooling of interest is discarded. It was misused. And so only acquisition is allowed. You have to follow acquisition method. But if there is merger within the group, within your group, one company is merged with another company. In that case, what to do? IFRS is silent. They say we will develop new standard. Until then, what to do? Left to the board. But under India, we said no, we would decide now that if it is within the group, we will follow pooling of interest method. That is the carve out from IndAS. That under Indian situation, we will follow pooling of interest if it is within the control. So here, pooling of interest and acquisition, pooling of interest method is out. But for common control, we will follow in India pooling of interest method. assets and liabilities have to be fair valued, every asset and liability. Excess of asset and liability goes to goodwill. Supposing you are paying more goodwill, no problem. If less negative goodwill, it goes to capital reserve under Indian situation. In IFRS, there is no capital reserve. There is no concept of capital reserve. They said that if you are taking over assets and liabilities, you are paying less. You are paying less. Is it possible? You are getting more than what you are paying. If there is something wrong, you in your revaluation of assets and liabilities. The standard requires do it again, reassess, take every asset and liability again, and then find out are you paying more or less. You have done reassessment 100%. Even contingent assets, contingent liabilities, everything you have valued. Still you find you are getting more than what you are paying. IFRS says, oh, you have earned profit. Take to the P&L. In India, we don't agree. You earn profit when you sell, here you are purchasing. You are purchasing another company. You earn profit when you sell, when you purchase. When you purchase, you can't earn profit. But IFRS says that be logical. You have required more than what you are giving. You have, if there is wrong valuation, do it again. But you have confirmed there is no wrong valuation. But still, answer is that we are paying, getting more than what we are paying. Why? It can happen. In life, everything can happen. Every rule has an exception, and everything can happen in the life. It can happen. The vendor is in distress. So vendor is ready to sell at a lower price. He agrees that I don't have other alternative. And we also agree, yes. So we are taking over more than what we are paying because, not because we are more smart, but because, not because he is a fool, but because he is in distress. So you have made a profit. IFRS says take to P&L. We don't agree. And we can't use capital reserve. And so, but there is another animal, other comprehensive income. Put it over there. And so it will be put to other comprehensive income. If it is insurance contracts, insurance companies, adequate liability for insurance, claims which may come in future, adequacy test is required. And if there is insurance taken, part of it is reinsured. You can't set off. You have to show both separately. All these rules are there. Non-current assets held for sale and discontinuing operation. If you have decided to dispose of part of the operation, your P&L account should show separate profit from continuing operation and discontinuing operation should be shown separately. And asset which is held for sale should be valued at the lower of the carrying value or the net realizable value, whichever is less. Exploration by mineral resources, we will not do that exploration right now. Operating segment, the segment reporting, how do you decide? How you decide if, I think we'll stop here. Other my slides will speak. So I will stop here. Please go.
Friends, you will agree that such a distilled knowledge in a capsule format can come only after terrific tapasya that we were witness to. Without taking much time, I now request Abhay to offer a very well-deserved vote of thanks, followed by a standing ovation, and before that, a few announcements.
President Nitin Singhala, Vice President Raman, seniors in the profession and dear friends. Before proposing the very hearty vote of thanks, I have some announcements and request the people to please be seated for 5 to 10 minutes. We had patience for 3 hours. At least we should have patience to acknowledge the efforts put in by Mr. N.P. Sarda. First of all, there is a very unique program which has been planned. A full-day conference on going digital, a brave new world at the MCA Club Bandra. For that, there will be very high-profile faculty which has been chosen. and it is a one of its kind program, so we request that everybody should try to take the opportunity of the same. There is a special price being now considered for students, which is at a 75% discount at rupees 1200. So enrollments are sought for, and kindly take the opportunity at the earliest. Then after this marathon lecture meeting, there are four more lecture meetings which have been planned in the next 35 days. First is on legal and tax aspects of trust with special reference to REITs, InvITs and AIFs, which is on the 17th of June at IMC, Wednesday. Speaker is Dilip Lakhani. Second lecture meeting is on filing of income tax return by Ganesh Rajgopalan. That will be on 24th of June at IMC. Later on, there is a lecture meeting which is on the founding day of the BCAS, which is on India's transformation opportunities and challenges by a celebrity speaker as Guru Murthy. That will be on the 6th of July at IMC. And last lecture meeting scheduled is on current issues in international taxation. That is normally the opening lecture meeting by Pinakin Desai, which will be on the 15th July. There is one RRC which has been planned on service tax and VAT, which is scheduled between 19th and 21st of June at Leonia Resorts, Hyderabad. And one workshop for independent directors has been planned by the Corporate and Securities Laws Committee, which is again at MCA Club on the 3rd of July, Friday. So kindly take the opportunity to enroll in some of the events. Coming to this pleasant task,
I may just announce that this rules, Companies Accounting Rules 2015, which lay down the 39 IndAS, runs into more than 700 pages. More than 700 pages rules in IndAS rules, 39 IndAS. It runs into more than 700 pages. I have been able to cover 80% of this. Main principles I have covered about 80%.
Friends, you will agree that there has been a substantial accretion in our knowledge base, which we would like to reflect in our professional balance sheet. Since the benefit of the accretion will be over the years while applying the concepts so clear after today's stellar performance, we shall place this accretion in our other comprehensive income and transfer to our P&L over the years while realizing the profits out of the same. And another thing is that though there may be no concept of extraordinary items in AS, today we have witnessed an extraordinary exposition on AS and IndAS, which we would like to recognize and acknowledge with a loud applause and a standing ovation. Thanks for the patience.